Hi to everybody that's in here. We're just going to wait a few more minutes for a few more people to roll in. We'll be starting around 2:15. Dr. Nicolas Lee is going to talk about the effects of space environment on spacecraft.
Welcome in, everyone. Andrew, I enjoyed your talk about ORSAT. It's definitely an interesting process building CubeSats.
It's a ridiculous process.
Yeah, we at Stanford, we actually had a CubeSat project that was part of the QB50 program.
Oh, yeah, you bet.
And we failed to launch it. We took something that was meant to be like 2 to 3 years. We had like tens of K worth of funding. And just the student turnover was too much. And with a specific launch with the rest of the constellation, we just couldn't meet the timeline.
So the key here, Nicolas, is to fail all the students constantly. And that way they have to stick around for years and then convince them they have to come back for grad school and then fail them again. So you get them for like 4 years.
Yeah, our challenge is that at Stanford, up until the past couple of years, we never had an undergrad program with aerospace. So
I didn't know that.
All of our spacecraft design was a master's level only class, which meant we had them for like 20 weeks.
Yeah, that's right.
They ramp up for 10.
That's not so good, actually.
They do stuff for 10. Some of them stick around for spring quarter, and then we've got a whole new batch the next year.
So I will say that there is a very interesting collaboration between Cal Poly Pomona and the Stanford folks now, Stanford SEDS group, I believe, and they're both looking at using ORSAT as their bus for a multi-satellite constellation, not constellation, that's the wrong word, a cluster of satellites going off at the same time, which is really interesting. But I am most excited for your talk because the this is environmental space effects on spacecraft are like, there's so much fear, uncertainty, and doubt, especially in the CubeSat community, that like I am sorry that you said yes to this, because we're gonna hound you mercilessly after this and ask you all sorts of questions. It's gonna be great.
I really want, like, especially since we're in Zoom, I'd like to just go rogue. And if you all want to like chime in and have questions throughout the whole talk, I'd be happy to just navigate through that rather than, I have enough stuff here to talk for probably 2 hours if you let me. But if questions come up in the meantime, feel free to like divert the discussion, and we can play that by ear, definitely.
Nicolas, if you're okay with that, that would be great. Maybe if there's something that's really pressing for us in particular for ORSAT, maybe we'll chime in and ask a pointed question. Thank you.
All right, it's 2:15. I think we should get started. Woohoo! I've got a little blurb here, some background on Dr. Nicolas Lee. Dr. Nicolas Lee is a research engineer at Stanford University, specializing in ground-based experiments and mission concept studies that explore the effects of the space environment on spacecraft. Current areas of research include the characterization of plasma formed by impacts of meteoroids and space debris on spacecraft, as well as mission concepts that use ultralight spacecraft in novel ways. Nicolas was previously a postdoctoral scholar in aerospace at the W.M. Keck Institute for Space Studies at Caltech, researching technologies for robotically assembled space telescopes, membrane structures for space solar power applications, and small satellite high voltage electronics, after obtaining a PhD in aeronautics and astronautics at Stanford University. Dr. Lee will be presenting Exploring the Space Environment and Its Effects on Spacecraft today, and we'll be discussing his past research on hypervelocity impacts in small satellites. As Dr. Nicolas Lee has said, if you have any questions today, feel free to chime in the chat whenever. You don't have to wait for the Q&A section at the end. So, Doctor, if you'd like to take it away.
Thanks so much, Cass, and thanks everyone for being here. It's been really interesting seeing everyone's talks throughout the day. And I wanted to start off my talk with a little bit of a bio. I know there's a lot of undergrads and a lot of high school students and general public who are here. So I wanted to start with how I got to where I am today with the work that I do. So this is me at 6. I visited Florida for the first time with my family, saw a bunch of rockets, got really excited about seeing like the large vehicle assembly building and everything. I'd love to go there again. I haven't been back since I was six, but just seeing that now that I've gotten all the background knowledge about aerospace would be really cool. After that, I got into Star Trek, and that really is a huge motivation in my life, just seeing this vision for the future, seeing how different people envision where humanity is going, and in a very positive way for the most part, seeing what sort of things we have to do, not just with technology, but with society, to be able to push towards that type of ideal future. And in high school, I ended up going to space camp. So this is where I first learned about basic orbital mechanics, built some model rockets, did a lot of team building and mission simulation exercises. And that really got me excited about just the whole aerospace engineering environment. Once I got into the University of Toronto, this was for my undergrad, I did aerospace engineering as part of the engineering science degree. I started working in aerospace engineering labs. So Project Ornithopter is a human flapping wing vehicle. We were trying to build an airplane that could actually fly by flapping its wings. I did a lot of extracurricular projects as well. So we built concrete canoes. That was part of taking an unconventional material and trying to build a structure out of it that concrete isn't very good for. Concrete is a material that does very well in compression. So when you squish it, it's very robust. But if you start to twist it or pull on it, it ends up being very weak, prone to cracking. And so designing a canoe out of it is a very interesting engineering challenge just from that perspective. Once I got to Stanford, this was around the time of the Google Lunar X Prize unveiling. So for a while, we were really interested in maybe starting our own Google Lunar X Prize team at Stanford that would sort of design or partner with someone who would build a lander and get us to build a lunar rover on the moon. The team fell apart, but a couple of us got some departmental funding to just sort of mess around it and see what we could do building a rover for like $2,000. So pretty much spare change from the eyes of the department, but it was plenty for us to get our hands dirty and start sort of designing things, experimenting, seeing how things broke down and fixing it. So this was a rover that we ended up building. This was back in 2007, so way before the era of live streaming of Zoom these days. And what we ended up doing was connecting an internet-based ground station to this rover and having a little video transmitter. So back in 2007, we managed to build this system that was a rover sitting at Stanford that we were broadcasting video off. So someone in Canada was watching us and someone in Mexico was logged into our control system, like being able to turn the motors and drive the thing back and forth. So that was sort of a pretty cool look ahead to what I think any of us could really do these days in the era of live streaming. Like the amount of things you can do through YouTube, through Twitch, it is pretty exciting compared to what we were capable of back then. We also did high altitude balloon launches. So this is a video that doesn't seem to be playing, but that basically what we had was a program where we would fill up these weather balloons with helium. We designed payloads that would go in them to look at astrobiology experiments. There were some DNA and UV reaction experiments. We did some solar sail deployment testing. And this was a nice way within the context of our spacecraft design class to have sort of a full end-to-end mission that we could do within the span of a quarter. So from planning the mission, outlining the payloads, getting notice to airmen, so flight authorization put together, and actually carrying out a mission, doing a launch, recovery, and then post-analysis of the mission. So all of this really gave me a lot more background into sort of the practical and operations side of things compared to just learning like the technical aspects of orbital mechanics, dynamics, chemistry, and all the math that goes behind it. So with that, I started my PhD doing robotic servicing. So I was really interested in, at the time, the Hubble robotic servicing mission, which was meant to replace the shuttle mission back when the shuttle was grounded after Columbia. From there, I sort of took a turn with lack of funding into looking at solar sailing, seeing if we could deploy solar sails out of CubeSats to be able to do orbital maneuvers using photon pressure from the sun. Played around with the concept of tethered satellites once I got into the CubeSat lab. And eventually, my PhD took this right-hand turn. We hired a new professor. I started working with her. This was Professor Siegfried Close, who's still at Stanford and who I still work for. And I started looking at meteoroid impacts and the concept of the plasmas that are formed from impacts and the electrical effects they might have on spacecraft. Once I finished my PhD, I went to Caltech. I looked a lot at deployable structures. So these ranged from large 100-meter telescope structures to, again, small CubeSat level deployables. And finally, once I got back to Stanford, I've been doing a lot of NASA-funded work that's more geared towards sort of early stage mission concept design, looking at what technologies we need to develop to be able to push forward different capabilities in space. So a lot of this ends up being wrapped around my interest in the space environment and how it interacts with spacecraft. So when you send something into space, it's immersed in all of these different physical effects. So within Earth orbit, you've got the geomagnetic field from the Earth. There's the spacecraft plasma sheath that can form. So within the Earth system, there's a lot of different plasmas. There's effects from the sun hitting different surfaces and different levels of illumination that can cause surface charging. The ionosphere is the ambient plasma within the atmosphere itself. And then from beyond, once you get into deep space, there's the effect of the solar wind, which is a different form of plasma, so different populations, different energies, radiation belts, meteoroids, orbital debris. Some of you may have heard the talk from this morning about the debris population in Earth orbit and how the Kessler syndrome might be making that a much bigger problem in the future. And then from even beyond the solar system, galactic cosmic rays, highly energetic particles coming in from other stars from elsewhere in the galaxy are issues that can impact spacecraft and cause problems. So in this talk, assuming everything goes according to plan, what I wanted to do was to start with various space environment effects, starting with the sun, planetary magnetospheres, and my personal interest in meteoroids and debris. And within each of these, I'll sort of touch on what the effects are of these particular phenomena, as well as particular projects that I've worked on in the past that sort of relate to these aspects. So it's going to be sort of a survey talk, and that's where if any of you do have questions or comments or just want to engage in discussion throughout, feel free to put up your hand or type something in the chat. And I'm happy to divert the flow of this talk to engage more with an interactive presentation than just me delivering content. So to start off, the sun is the most massive object in our solar system. It's about 10 to the 30 kilograms. So that's 10 with 30 zeros after it. It's about 150 million kilometers from the Earth, or about 8 light minutes. And the main effect that acts on spacecraft from the sun, other than its gravitational pull, which obviously pulls everything around within the solar system, is that it emits stuff. It's spewing out both electromagnetic radiation in the form of photons and over a wide wavelength, as well as ionized mass. So this is the solar wind that I mentioned earlier. If you look at the sun, this is a picture of the sun from the Solar Dynamics Observatory. The sun looks very, very different in different wavelengths. So I mentioned electromagnetic radiation. This occurs over a range of wavelengths. We personally see in the visible, which is the picture that I'm seeing here. This is what the sun looks like to our eyes. If you go higher and higher in frequency, you get like the blues, purples, and eventually the ultraviolets and higher energy electromagnetic spectrum. If you go lower and lower, you get the reds and then the infrared, eventually getting down to radio waves and much lower frequency emissions. So if you look at the sun in one of these other frequencies, this is going down to a 304 nanometer wavelength compared to visible. And you see a lot more structure within the solar corona. Going even further down, you see more of the magnetic field effects that the sun has occurring over its surface. One of the things that we've been looking at, this is a Caltech project that I was involved with a couple years ago, was to look at the concept of space-based solar power. So this is the idea that the sun is obviously emitting a lot of energy. And on Earth, we can capture this energy through photovoltaic panels. But if we put solar panels on Earth, they're at best working half the time. So even in completely clear weather, as the Earth is rotating, your solar panels are going to eventually get to the night side of the planet and then rotate back into the day side. So there's a lot of off time in solar power if you base it on the Earth. And once you factor in atmospheric absorption and weather, clouds shading your solar panels, you end up cutting that efficiency lower and lower down. So one of the things we were looking at was, what are some concepts that would make feasible the idea of putting a giant solar array in space that would capture photovoltaic energy? So capture solar power 24/7 in orbit. And as it's capturing this energy, directly convert that to microwaves, which is something that can transmit basically through all weather and down to the surface, whether it's day or night, and basically give us 24/7 solar power. So the idea here was to take some prior designs. So a lot of people have come up with concepts for large kilometer scale structures that have a giant solar array, convert that all to electricity, funnel that down a big cable to a giant radio transmitter, and then beam that energy down. And that whole structure is unfortunately pretty massive in order to put everything there. So in terms of the cost of getting all of that to space, it becomes intractable. What we were looking at was a way to formation fly very lightweight solar concentrators that would each sort of locally convert to microwave and beam down in a sort of phased array antenna pattern. So the idea was we could avoid the large structure holding everything together if we can rely on sort of membrane structures and deployables and just formation fly it. So this is the basic idea of a 10 by 10 centimeter tile that we developed. The solar concentrators are something that look like a Venetian blind. So if you imagine the sun beaming energy down from the vertical direction, each of these blind panel veins is basically a parabolic concentrator that takes all of the energy impinging on this entire silver reflective surface and concentrates it onto a very thin strip of photovoltaics that occurs right at the edge. And once it converts to PV, you've got direct current electricity that you can push down to an RF transmitter with a patch antenna on the second level of this membrane structure. And all of this is supported using these little S springs that allow you to take this whole thing and basically squish it flat. And if you can squish it flat, you can sort of roll it up, you can package it and deploy it from a much smaller structure. And that makes it a lot easier to package something, put it in a rocket, launch it into space, and then unfurl it. So I'm seeing a question in chat about how the photovoltaics at the focal point not melting. That's definitely a part of the thermal design. So part of it is looking at, can we, so if we're looking at just the light impinging on one particular panel here, that that's still not too much energy overall for this like 2 centimeter by 10 centimeter strip. So that is the amount of energy that gets concentrated into the thin strip at the top. This was an initial prototype. We hadn't done any thermal design specifically here, but the idea is that the photovoltaics at the top would be able to convert electricity, but also sort of radiate or conduct their thermal energy down through the structure to a radiator panel. And so the idea is we would take these tiles and sort of put them, arrange them in panels that would form a sort of 60 by 60 meter deployable spacecraft. And then that spacecraft would be formation flying with a lot of other ones. So overall, it's very decoupled. I'm seeing another question about very dangerous if the space-based component got misaligned, or would it be really spread out rather than sending energy in a tight beam? So the calculations we had were that even if we had a 3 by 3 kilometer formation or constellation that was gathering gigawatt level energy, once we put that all together and have a very, as tight as possible, RF beam that broadcasts down to a receiving ground station, the actual amount of RF energy density at the peak of that beam is lower than the health limits that would really impact anything. Like ultimately, you're taking all of this energy and you're beaming it down to, relative to the planet, a very small point on the surface, but that point is still like a 10 by 10 kilometer receiving rectenna array, for example. So the amount of energy, for example, for a bird flying through our beam isn't going to be something that would really affect a human or a bird or an animal biologically. So one of the things we were looking at, and this was one of the experiments we ran at Caltech, I'm hoping that this video is playing. This was an experiment we conducted to sort of develop a way to fold and deploy membranes in a way that accounts for thickness of the membrane and that allows everything to deploy elastically. So one of the big challenges in whether you're building a solar sail or a much bigger scale solar receiver, solar panels, whatever, is that if you're trying to package what seems to be an ideal membrane, physically you end up getting to the point where you're stacking all of these layers, and as you start wadding it up, it builds up thickness. So what we did here was we designed a membrane structure that is composed of strips. So I'm going to pause this here. You can see that every single one of these strips along this diagonal is basically contiguous. So these would be, if scaled up to the full scale, equivalent to like a contiguous array of those 10 by 10 centimeter panels arranged in, let's say, a half meter by 60 meter strip. And what we did was we designed these little slipping hinges along the fold direction, where when we Z-fold everything, so if we go back to this, when it's Z-folded like this, the main crease lines are creases that are allowed to shear with respect to each other. So as we start wrapping this up, the parts of the structure that are on the inside surface, so this side of the surface compared to the outer side, they're traveling a shorter distance. And so they're allowed to slip relative to the strip next to it and slide so that they don't end up sort of crumpling and buckling the way they would if the hinges were actually conventional crease lines of a contiguous structure. So this was just one of the things we were doing, where once we deploy this out, we can sort of tighten the corners and get a fairly flat surface that isn't subject to major creasing from plastic deformation of the crease itself. and that this was work that I was doing as a postdoc down at Caltech. This, as I mentioned, the idea of using these membrane structures is also really relevant to solar sailing. So that this is another phenomenon related to the electromagnetic emission of the sun. So the photons are kind of strange, where the light emitted by the sun, if you think of them from a photon perspective, is something that has energy. It has momentum, even if it has zero mass. And so what solar sailing does is it uses the principle of this photon pressure, where if you take light and you shine it on an object, the light being absorbed by the surface of the object, as well as any light that's reflected or emitted back, will result in momentum transfer to the object. So if you imagine just shining a flashlight on a mirror, the mirror will experience a very slight bit of force that pushes it away. And so if you put the mirror in space and let the sun shine on it, and you make the mirror lighter and lighter and lighter, it experiences a much greater acceleration than it would if you were doing the same thing on Earth. So again, the idea is we want to package something very compactly for the purpose of launching on a rocket, and then once we get into space, deploying it out into a large, flat, lightweight structure. So this was something I did as a PhD student, where we were looking at deploying different thickness membranes using different packaging strategies. This is something that we conducted experiments on the Vomit Comet. We did about 80 parabolas of microgravity flights. This was sponsored by NASA, where they gave us these flight opportunities to be able to sort of provide our own hardware. They would provide the airplane, and we got to sort of play around in zero G, which was a lot of fun. And you can sort of see some of the, I'm gonna again pause this. If you look at this particular membrane, this was one of the thicker membranes. This is what motivated a lot of the later work at Caltech, where I was looking at the slip wrap formation. But this membrane was thick enough that we weren't able to package it conventionally, whereas this thinner membrane here was a lot more amenable to just very quickly unfurling and flattening out. So that this one ended up having a lot fewer wrinkles, or wrinkles of a much smaller scale, at least, whereas we were having trouble with this particular one of getting any of these crease lines to completely unfold mechanically once it had sort of developed that plastic deformation along the crease. So this was definitely an interesting exercise in just understanding what sort of effects occur. That this was a different folding pattern, where we were looking at trying to fold everything into a quadrant rather than sort of wrapping it around a spiral. And one of the issues here was sort of this mechanical buckling of the booms. So you can see here, as it unfolds, the tension, or the tension right at the tips is pulling the booms. And because in this form, the booms themselves have to unfurl separately from the membrane, there's no intermediate support, and the booms, which are just tape measures, end up just collapsing. Whereas in the spiral wrapped version here, the booms are fairly good at staying straight, just because they're attached all the way along the diagonal. What if your membrane gets hit with more powerful particles, like high energy cosmic radiation, neutrons, or even microasteroids? So meteoroid penetration is definitely a problem. It's something where you'll likely just get a hole through it. In terms of higher energy radiation, that can definitely cause changes in your material itself. So if you're using something like polyethylene or some form of polymer, a lot of those end up being impacted both by radiation as well as by just UV emission. So there are there has to be a very careful selection of what materials you use in space. If you use something like a nylon, it tends to break down under UV. So you wouldn't want to use that for a solar sail, for example, where you're trying to have this membrane survive for, let's say, years on end. There are some pretty advanced or theoretical solar sail concepts where, so with what I'm showing you here, this is basically just mylar. This is the plastic by itself, which is transparent. To make it a solar sail, you'd want to aluminize it or coat it with a very thin layer of metal. And if you recall, I was talking about how the lighter your solar sail is, the more effective it would be. And what I'd like to, what people have proposed is the idea that you can take something like aluminized mylar, for example, where you start with a polymer substrate, you deposit aluminum on it. And then let's say you take this thing, you fold it up, package it, you launch it into orbit, and you deploy it. Now, once it's deployed, the forces on your structure after deployment are going to be very different from the ones through launch and through deployment itself. You don't necessarily need the strength of the mylar membrane. So what if you make it out of a polymer that breaks down? And in that case, what you can do is sort of launch something into orbit, deploy it, and then evaporate all of the plastic. And once the plastic's gone, you end up with a much lower mass structure composed of just a very thin gossamer metal. And that itself would be a much higher performance solar sail because it's not having to accelerate all of the mylar or other polymer that you have attached to it before. That's definitely a good question. And it's something where, again, going back to Andrew's comment about CubeSats, a lot of CubeSat design doesn't worry about too much long-term space survivability. A lot of CubeSats are launched into low Earth orbit where they deorbit within 2 to 3 years. So you don't need it to survive, let's say, in the radiation belt or for 20 years on end. And so the level of robustness to the space environment that you design for CubeSats is usually going to be a lot lower than for, let's say, a Cassini or a Juno that's going out to the outer solar system and you expect it to last for, let's say, 15, 20 years, both on the way there and then around the planet you're trying to study. And that kind of gets into the next topic. I wanted to touch on planetary magnetospheres. So I mentioned a bit about solar winds and how the sun doesn't just emit electromagnetic radiation, it also emits ionized particles in the form of plasma. I wanted to touch a bit on what a plasma actually is. So we often describe plasma as an ionized gas or just the fourth state of matter, where if you start with a material, you can start it as a solid. If you increase its energy, it might get into a liquid state, increase its energy further, it gets into a gaseous state. And then as you start increasing its energy beyond that, you start kicking electrons off of the molecules or the atoms, and you start getting positive ions, negative electrons, and that's what sort of forms a plasma. More specifically, if we're talking about an ideal plasma, we have a couple extra conditions that we apply just for something to be a plasma as opposed to just an ionized gas. So first thing is we require there to be a large number of particles. So if you have a single electron or a single ion, that we wouldn't call that a plasma. There have to be enough. There has to be enough of a large population that it has much more of a collective effect. And not only does it have to be a large number of particles, but it has to have a very small shielding thickness. So a plasma, because it has very mobile electrons that are separate from ions, it behaves sort of like a metal in that if you have external electric fields or magnetic fields, a plasma will change the surface charge distribution based on the movement of electrons to shield out any fields on the inside of the plasma. So if you have, for example, just ions or just a cloud of electrons, you don't necessarily get that effect because you don't have this sort of quasi-neutral population. Whereas if you have a balanced charge population and enough density or enough energy within there for the electrons to move and shield out fields, then you get a lot more interesting physics that come into play within the bulk of the plasma that's quasi-neutral. If it's basically a roughly balanced number of electrons and ions, then you can sort of set up oscillations, you can set up waves, and a lot of those effects end up being what makes plasmas an interesting topic to study. The final thing is that the plasmas typically are referred to as collisionless. So the population has to be rarefied enough that it's not behaving like a fluid, it's behaving like a plasma. And that's what allows the electromagnetic effects to be dominant over things like pressures or other more collisional effects. So in, for example, a gas turbine engine, you'll have enough energy during combustion to ionize a lot of the material, but the flow through the engine is still dominated by collisional effects. It's going to be pushed by pressure out through the turbine blades, out through the nozzles, and that's not really behaving like a plasma. A plasma will be sort of, the particles will be spaced far enough apart that they don't really feel the pressure of each other. They feel the electrostatic, electromagnetic effects. And so as the solar wind, which is composed of this plasma, encounters planets, a lot of planets do have magnetic fields from the dipoles that are in their inner cores. And these magnetic fields cause what are called solar wind bow shocks. And these are magnetic shocks. They're not fluid shocks. So again, it's not a collisional effect. It's the fact that when you have particles that are charged coming in to see a magnetic field, when they start seeing the magnetic field, they start spinning around those field lines. And because of that, you end up getting something that resembles a collisional shock. And so with our planetary magnetosphere, the fact that the Earth has this magnetic field around it, that's what protects us from the solar wind just impinging and impacting into our atmosphere and possibly stripping it off. The other effect of the magnetosphere is that it creates what are called radiation belts. And these are sort of regions within the magnetosphere where the highly energetic particles that are coming in from the solar wind can end up getting trapped, and you end up getting a very condensed region around the Earth where you have much higher energy particles, higher densities of these electrons or protons. And so if you're flying through these environments, you end up having to worry about much more ionizing radiation effects than if you were just flying in the low Earth atmosphere or low Earth orbit or further out in geostationary orbit. If these ever escape, that these high energy particles, as they escape and funnel down through the poles of our magnetosphere, that's what can cause our aurora as the highly energetic particles come in and actually do impact our atmosphere. So there are a lot of effects that go on both far outside of Earth's orbit to closer in intermediate orbits, as well as down to the Earth's atmosphere. One of the projects that I'm looking at right now, this is a project that's funded by NASA, is to look at an early low technology readiness idea for studying the magnetosphere around Uranus. So the interesting thing about Uranus is that I think most people know that the planet itself is rotating on its side. It's basically got a 90 degree inclination of its rotational axis. But in addition to that, the magnetic dipole is sort of offset from the center of mass. So it's not just spinning, but it's also sort of whipping around very rapidly. And what's interesting thing about that is that you end up sort of having this magnetic dipole that can, at certain seasons, be sort of broadside to the solar wind, and at other times it's sort of rotated 90 degrees and it's funneling solar wind energy directly into the planet. And so what we're looking at is a long duration mission that's required to study these dynamics. And what the concept that we're looking at is to deploy very lightweight probes that use a laser beamed from a mothership, something that looks like Cassini, that would sort of direct laser energy out in a certain direction. We would inject a probe into that laser beam and use the laser energy to power the probe. the idea here is that once we have, once we're sort of locked into the idea of having a laser and having a very lightweight probe, what we're studying right now is how much else can we offload to the laser? Can we put on reflectors that we control? And again, similar to the solar sail concept, can we put on differential reflectors that allow us to control the way the probe's pointing? Or can we blink the reflectors on and off to be able to communicate? And that way we can avoid having to use thrusters, we can avoid using a radio, and we can make our probe lighter and lighter and lighter. And in that way, we can maybe have 20 to 30 probes that are tiny, tiny 10 centimeter sized spacecraft compared to, for example, two or three spacecraft that are maybe half a meter in size. And one of the things that we've been really focused on studying is how these probes will survive in that environment, what sort of capabilities they have as the size of the probe gets larger and larger, and the ability to navigate within the laser beam goes lower and lower. And that's going to bring me to the final topic I wanted to talk about, meteoroids and debris. I'm definitely running a little behind schedule, in part because of the questions, which is what I asked for. But this is where I did the bulk of my PhD research, was looking at meteoroids and debris and what happens when they impact spacecraft and when they impact the atmosphere. I wanted to start off with some nomenclature. So meteoroids are the particle in space, the naturally occurring particles. When they enter an atmosphere and start burning up, the plasma that's formed from this is what we call a meteor. And when it actually lands and hits the surface of the planet, that's what's called the meteorite. So it's one of the pet peeves we have when people talk about meteorites in space or meteor showers, when they're not talking about the actual plasma, they're talking about the meteoroids impacting spacecraft. Just to get a sense of the sizes and speeds, meteoroids tend to go a lot faster than space debris because they're coming into the Earth system from outside of Earth's gravity well. So typically we see meteoroids at Earth that are traveling at between 11 and 72 kilometers per second, compared to space debris, which tend to travel at 7 to 10 kilometers per second. And we heard a lot about space debris earlier this morning. Meteoroids tend to also be a lot smaller. We get a lot more tiny dust specks that have been processed through the eons of collisions in the solar system compared to the larger paint flecks, nuts and bolts that are the dominant population of space debris. In general, what we're looking at in terms of impacts on spacecraft is for every square meter in low Earth orbit, we expect to see a nanogram-sized particle hit every day. And this tends to vary depending on your particular orbit, how much you're being shielded by the Earth, and is a lot more variable for the debris population than for the meteorite population. The way we look at meteors, we do a lot of studies of meteors. This has been going on since the 1600s, really, of observing them as they're burning up through the atmosphere. These days, we look at them using optical instruments like cameras, as well as radar, that send radio pulses into the atmosphere, bounce off the meteor itself, the plasma, and then we receive the signal back to the radar. This is something I did just a couple of years ago. This is the Hikamarka Radio Observatory with a large array of dipole antennas. And this is sort of an example of the data that we collect. So we're sending radar pulses into the atmosphere, and what we get back are all of these little pulses that are the meteoroids traveling through our atmosphere and burning up at about 100 kilometers altitude. And you can sort of see other plasma effects that are sort of flowing through that altitude as well. And this is one night of data from midnight here through about 6 a.m., 8 a.m. This is when the sun rises. And there's an interesting effect here where as the sun rises, it's causing the atmosphere to heat up. So that's pushing all of the particles in our atmosphere upward. And as the atmosphere rises, it's traveling through our Earth's magnetosphere. So we've got charged particles, ions and electrons that are being pushed in a particular direction through a magnetic field, which causes electrons to go one way perpendicular to your upward direction, and ions to go the other way. And that's what forms this beam of yellow here, which is the electrojet. So as this, you get into the daylight, there's this stream of electrons that sort of flows across the equator because of this effect, which is a pretty cool aspect of the Earth geospace environment. And this is a close-up of one of the meteors that we actually see, where you can sort of see the head echo. This is the particle itself coming down and the plasma that's around the particle. And it leaves this sort of streak of plasma behind that persists for a number of seconds. The other aspect that we look at is, what if we have a sudden impact? So rather than burning up gradually through the atmosphere, what if we suddenly impact a hard surface like a spacecraft or an asteroid? This is something that causes a very quick deposition of the kinetic energy of a meteoroid or space debris particle onto the surface. It vaporizes and ionizes and causes a formation of a very dense plasma on the surface of the spacecraft. And what we've been really interested in is the formation of that plasma, and as it expands, whether it's emitting in radio emissions to be able to possibly cause electrical damage to spacecraft. We've done a number of ground-based experiments. This is at dust accelerators, like one in Germany and one in Colorado, as well as light gas guns, which shoot larger particles at a slower speed. This is just a quick plot showing from a size range and from a speed range. Meteoroids tend to live in this area, so they're really fast, mostly small, but can get into the big sizes. Debris is more slow and large and can be pretty well replicated by light gas guns, but it's pretty hard to replicate meteoroid impacts on Earth. The dust accelerators that we have can really only replicate the speeds to very, very small particles, like femtogram-sized impactors. So in terms of the experiments that we've conducted, we tend to have a suite of plasma RF optical sensors that we use to observe these impacts that we're conducting on the ground. These are some videos showing impacts that we did at NASA Ames Vertical Gun Range. So this is a 50 kilo frame per second high-speed video. So that this is really slowed down. On the left, I'll play it again. This is an impact of a 5 kilometer per second, 5 milligram particle onto a piece of tungsten. And you can see all of these fragments of particulate matter that are shooting off. We were also looking at regolith simulants. So this is looking more at what would happen on an asteroid or sort of a dusty surface. And you can sort of see, compared to the one on the left, this tungsten is a very dense, hard material, and you can see there's a very sharp impact and a lot of sort of horizontal expansion. You can see this ring of plasma that's expanding out around the point of impact before all the particles come out. With the dust impact, it penetrates a lot more deeply into the surface, and that forms a much tighter cone. So the expansion of the plasma and the solid ejecta is very different depending on the surface that you hit. And so one thing we were looking at was this idea of, what if we could take these impacts and use them to study the space environment? So we know meteoroids are impacting spacecraft all the time, or we see that in Earth orbit. And we know meteoroids are prevalent throughout the solar system. So what is the nature of impacts of meteoroids on asteroid surfaces? And we were thinking, if we're looking at the plasma coming off of an impact to infer what the material was of that impactor, what if we could do the same thing on asteroids? What if we have plasma sensors floating around an asteroid and looking at meteoroids hitting the surface of the asteroid and the plasma that's coming off? And so the idea is, if we pick an asteroid, let's say that this particular 400 meter near Earth asteroid, and we send a CubeSat out to this asteroid, what's the smallest sort of spacecraft that can really give us anything useful out of it? And that's where, by taking advantage of the fact that meteoroids are always hitting the surface, we don't have to really put our own probes to sample the surface of the asteroid. The meteoroids are doing that for us. And what we're doing is we're just putting remote sensors, all of these lightweight probes that are floating around the asteroids, looking at the impact plasma. And depending on how long it takes for the plasma to get from the surface of the asteroid to our probe, that can sort of tell us what the mass of the plasma particles are. And that tells us what the surface of the asteroid actually is. So that this was, again, a NIAC project that was funded to look at sort of these sort of pie in the sky concepts that really wouldn't be possible with today's technology, but might be looking 10, 15 years into the future. What sort of things might we be capable of if we develop the technology to do so? And so we were looking at developing these sensor spacecraft, what sort of lightweight plasma sensors we could build out of membranes, and this sort of folds in all of the prior work that I was looking at: deployable structures, solar sails, and reflectors, solar concentrators. And the big challenge here is that asteroids aren't very massive compared to, for example, the Earth. If you put a solar sail around the Earth, it's basically going to still orbit around the Earth until you do a lot of work with the sunlight reflecting off of it. Around the asteroid, it's very easy for the sunlight to just very quickly push our very lightweight probes out of orbit and just into deep space, or deorbit the probe and have it crash onto the surface. So what we were looking at was trying to identify stable orbit families where there's a particular geometry of orbit, which is basically around the polar terminator. So what we want to do is we want to arrange our orbit around the asteroid so that it's orbiting around the edge of the sunlit side and the shadowed side of the asteroid. And what that means is our orbit plane is perpendicular to the sun direction, and the sun is basically pushing sideways on our orbit rather than accelerating or decelerating our spacecraft. And that gives us sort of a uniform perturbation that keeps our orbit stable, as opposed to one that's sort of biased on one side and deorbits the spacecraft. So that's kind of the type of work that I've been doing recently, looking at taking the space environment and treating it not just as a threat, but as something that's sort of useful, something that we can take advantage of. I do want to acknowledge the fact that all of these projects that I've worked on wouldn't be possible without funding from a lot of different agencies. So the microgravity flights were NASA funded, the SCATTER and the Medea concepts were both NASA Space Technology Mission Directorate projects. Los Alamos National Labs, DOE, and Air Force have all funded a lot of our hypervelocity impact experiments. The meteor radar was more on the NSF side, and the space solar power was funded by Northrop Grumman at the time. And so just wrapping up, since I'm running out of time, I do want to leave some time for a bit of Q&A at the end. I wanted to emphasize that we do have to worry about the space environment. We've heard a lot about space debris impacts from prior talks. We've heard about CubeSats and the design factors that go into them. They can be hazardous to spacecraft, and a lot of space missions have failed because they didn't properly account for the space environment, but it also can be a resource. It's a valuable source of energy. It's a valuable source of information, and just learning about it is a major direction that scientific research is taking. And especially for a lot of the students here, I really want to hammer home the fact that there's still a lot for everyone to learn. The things that I've presented here are basically the state of the knowledge that we have about our solar system, about the space mission and the technologies that we're using. But not everything we know is right. There's a lot of turnover in our understanding of what is and isn't correct in science, or what is and isn't feasible. So be bold, keep challenging, keep exploring the world around you, keep asking questions, and that's just keep learning and find your own way to make things happen. And that sort of brings me back to my initial talk, where in my bio, I sort of touched on how I started on a space robotics. I went into deployable structures. I ended up in meteorite impacts, then deployable structures. And I was kind of all over the place. And life does have a tendency to take a curvy path. And I feel like a lot of this comes from making particular decisions, but not necessarily making the right decisions. It's more taking the decision you make and making that work for you, taking the experiences you have and pulling those to your advantage so that you can actually apply those in whatever projects you have to work on. And that's where I want to leave off. So if anyone has questions, now would be the time. Thank you.
Well said, Doctor. Great words of wisdom. Looks like we've got a question here for you in the chat. Oh, and Andrew.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay.
There's a question about the asteroid survey. And how technologically ready are we for a mission like the asteroid survey? So I think sending a CubeSat out to an asteroid is definitely feasible. The idea of making very lightweight chipsets that can fly around there is sort of on the sketchy end of, I don't think NASA will actually want to do that. NASA is in some ways hobbled by public perception. They have to defend everything they do to Congress. They have to justify their use of public funds. So compared to SpaceX or commercial, NASA has to be much more risk averse in anything they do. And so the point of Medea was to sort of look at technologies that might enable a startup like Planetary Resources or Planet Labs or a company like that to be able to make very cheap spacecraft that they can afford to send, let's say 50 of these to 50 different asteroids all at the same time, instead of like really homing in and spending $100 million on one spacecraft to go to one asteroid. And so it's doable. There's still the question of how long will these spacecraft survive? So the radiation environment in deep space is going to be pretty hostile to unshielded electronics. The lighter you make your spacecraft, the less shielding you have, and the lower likelihood that it'll survive. But the lighter you make it, the more of these you can send out, and then maybe if a few of them fail, it doesn't matter. So there is that risk-benefit trade-off of going cheap and plentiful versus expensive and survivable. The other aspect is we don't know that much about the electromagnetic environment around the asteroids themselves. So the idea of tracking the plasma expansion out to the surface, from the surface, the point of impact, to our plasma sensors over that 100 to 400 meter distance, whether we can actually get useful information out of that in terms of composition is something we've been looking to study, but we haven't had an opportunity to really dive into characterizing what the uncertainties are there of what happens if there's an unknown magnetic field that's diverting the plasma to a different direction. What if it's not taking a straight line path to our spacecraft? So those are the uncertainties that would sort of shift whether we can actually get anything useful out of that particular technique.
One of the interesting opportunities that we did not get, but it may come up in the future for ORSAT, is the ability to go to a high LEO orbit, or almost a MEO. And one of the questions that we've popped up besides the radiation is surface charging. People seem to be very, very, very worried about surface charging. Can you talk a little bit about that if you know anything about it and sort of describe it?
Yeah, so there are various forms of mechanisms that cause charging on spacecraft. And so if you have a spacecraft and it's immersed in a plasma, the temperature of the plasma, depending on your ambient environment, is what can cause the surface to charge. So that comes from the fact that electrons and ions have different masses. They have different absolute velocities if they're at the same temperature. And so what tends to happen is, depending on your material, you can absorb a different rate of electrons as you do ions. And depending on what material you have, that can also emit electrons at a different rate depending on how, what the secondary electron yields are and stuff like that. So with all of those physics, what ends up happening is you build up this plasma sheath around your spacecraft that can cause the spacecraft itself to float to some voltage that you don't necessarily expect. If you have a spacecraft that's large enough, immersed in different densities of plasmas, that can sort of form a current loop. And we've seen that with tethered spacecraft. There have been spacecraft like the tethered TSS, tethered space experiment, forget what it stood for, that deployed a several kilometer tether off of the space shuttle. And it built up enough of a charge differential that it was driving a lot of current through the tether itself to the point that the tether snapped because of a short. The other aspect is illumination. If the sun is shining on a surface, it can kick electrons off and create a different charge compared to the shaded area. So if you have different shielded areas of your spacecraft, solar panels deploying and casting a shadow on part of your body, that can also cause a problem. So a lot of that is combated by proper grounding of the spacecraft. So if you have all of your chassis and solar panels grounded to sort of a central hub, then the conductivity through those surfaces will drive a lot of these ambient currents so that they're not actually being pushed through, let's say, a cable where you can't withstand those currents. So it's on a CubeSat, I feel like it's a lot less of a concern because your scales are a lot smaller, your voltages are a lot smaller. For large geostationary spacecraft where you're developing like 100 volt potentials across your solar panels, it can be a much bigger problem.
Yeah, that was a great description. Thank you. That was really good.
Does anybody else have any questions for Dr. Lee?
Thanks everyone for being here.
Thank you for being here. I would like to know, are you a dog person or a cat person? Or neither? You can be neither.
Yes. I am slightly allergic to cats, but same. I like them. I am, there's a particular dog that I'm very fond of. I do pet sit for Professor Close fairly often. She comes from a family with currently two dogs, one cat, two guinea pigs. And so it's quite a menagerie.
Oh my.
One of those dogs is pretty attached to me when I go pet sit.
Oh, friendship.
Thank you so much.
Thank you again. And I'm sure we'll talk to you soon. Closing remarks are happening in about a minute here. I've dropped a link into the Zoom chat. Oh my God.
That's Cookie.
That's great. What? Oh. Anyways, closing your bikes at 3:15. I can't wait to pet my next dog. That's going to be a great day. Thank you again, doctor, for your time.
Take care. Bye, everyone.